is an illustration from Lessig, Lawrence Lessig, big IT law professor. And this was when he did this four paradigms about regulating the internet, in the advent of the internet. And I applied it to regulating blockchain, for instance, or let's say Bitcoin. How do they compare? And the analogy he gives is simple. There's four ways you can regulate something. Either you laws, norms, the market, or the architecture. The example it gives is, let's say, cigarettes. So with law, you can say only adults above 18 years old can smoke, right? With norms, you can do these social campaigns that show the bad side of smoking, cancer, kids, things like that. With the architecture, you can say, we want the nicotine stick to be a certain length and certain width. And that controls the amount of nicotine inside, right? And that also controls the levels of addiction. You can also have the market controlling it. So let's say like in Italy, the state has a monopoly on selling cigarettes, right? Yeah.
Not one.
Sorry? No, it's just that the state controls it. No, there's no other distributor, and it's because a lot of them smoke, so they have a lot of money. So there's always this tendency of law wanting to come back and sit up on top. And that's what I'm saying, eventually the law regulation will come into this domain. Because they always feel inferior if you just give us this one book as lawyers. You can see. So we're kind of entitled, yet when you come to it, you don't understand hashing functions, you don't understand yet code. And that's a problem. So if you look at law, for instance, the state of New York has issues a BIT license. Right? And that's an easy step. So let's say if you're talking to the task force, maybe you can start a task force.
I think our next event would be let's engage the task force.
Yeah.
We actually invite them. We give them a few pointers of all these things.
Yeah. So it's hard to control the architecture, especially if it's public, but it's easier to control an entity here in Nairobi that is based in Timau Plaza, right? And that you can give a license to and that you can freeze assets of and etc. You can make sure that they, let's say, have security, they have cybersecurity programs to make sure that their stuff is safe. They have, let's say, insurance to protect the people that are investing in that company, things like that, right? The other way is, let's say, you can use norms, so societal norms, as I was saying. In this case, CBK came and issued a public notice, right? There's a court case also that was by the late Justice Onguto about Bitpesa versus Safaricom, right? When they closed their API to them. The other way you can control or you can regulate is through efficiency, and market efficiency is very brutal. Right, so you can either trade on the NSE, this is the Nairobi Stock Exchange, or you can trade on the Bitpesa forex-driven blockchain. Exchange platform that is blockchain-driven. Right, and here you can transfer for very little money and things like that, but you also accommodate the risk in terms of security. Here you pay a price. It's the same thing. Like, but then in this case, Bitpesa versus Safaricom, the court refused to recognize Bitpesa as a money remittance provider and also a national payment system provider, right? So that affects you, and that's why they decided, well, voila, bye-bye, and they went to other places. So here with the architecture, like you were saying, it's easier to control a permission system, which also brings in the vulnerabilities of having an administrator or human interface who will give your 20 hectares to someone else. But it's much easier to have control a permission system than an unpermission system, and all of them are ways to regulate. So when you think about when we have this argument, is code law or vice versa? Yes, if it's a smart contract right now that just says sell X amount of shares at the end of a month or a number of securities, that's pretty straightforward. But when you have to deal with the issues of legal interpretation, of ambiguity, of other clauses that would need interpretation, it becomes trickier. And that's where we have to ask, how do we move onto a platform like this, a structure like this? So, and you see again, what we were saying, the discussion someone talked about, these are ex ante. This means you define the law and the norms, maybe even prior, mostly prior, the law. And considering the legislative process, right, How long has the data protection bill been in Parliament?
2013.
Exactly.
2012.
That's a legislative process. Will you wait for that to commercialize your business model? You cannot. So you have to move ahead. But the low-hanging fruit is maybe control the people that are doing these things, and then you reduce the scams. Maybe even if you issue, let's say, a license, for instance, if the task force were to say issue a license, it would be easier to use that as a first step and then see what else can we be able to do. With the market, let's say, the Bitpesa Forex exchange has been operating okay for the number of years that it's been around, right? The architecture that entails immutability and entails security and things like that has also been working okay. People have said, actually, the proof of Bitcoin is that it's still not been hacked as of itself. Maybe people have exploited the vulnerabilities to the architectures connecting to it, but not itself. So that's basically how we should start thinking about regulation, even as lawyers, as you know. And then you will never have to stop understanding the architecture as a lawyer. You have to. So in my thesis, I proposed something called a compliance pattern. And a compliance pattern needs you to understand the business model. And I had to move into business modeling. I majored in value modeling to understand the business, because one of the complaints when I did a survey of startups is that they said, yes, even this incubator has lawyers, but they are not skilled enough to understand my business model for it to be a formidable force. Either they tell me things that initiate it, or they make it difficult for me to be able to commercialize my business model. So I had to learn business model. The next thing I had to learn was legal theory. So there's over 11 types of legal interpretation kind of schemes, and they're grouped into themes, let's say like mutual interpretation, systemic interpretation, teleological interpretations, arguments from intention, and things like that. And all of them come into interpretation. Now, when you think about that from a smart contract perspective, for a lawyer, that it look very naive, saying, oh, this is a contract. No, you don't think it's a contract because you just think, okay, maybe it's a set of instructions. But so you had to, I had to learn the legal theory to understand, first of all, how to identify a legal risk in a business model and be able to manage it. Then the third component I had to learn was requirements engineering. Requirements engineering is the branch of software engineering that develops requirements for systems. So you have a requirements engineer that will come and sit with you, Kivuva, and say, well, for your record management system, what do you want? Okay. And then they get the requirements and they translate them into code. Now, the problem is, you know, the issues of translation, ambiguity, you said X, I understood Y, and things like that. Once you manage the legal risk here, you have to translate it into code that can be programmed, right? And then when you come into your, let's say, these things we call strategy maps, a strategy map will have like four levels. So here you have the business part. You have, this is really the business. And this will be profit, loss, things the business understands to make sense, right? But then when you come here to the user, they need to understand what value are you giving the user, let's say shareholders and things like that. So here it's a value to the user. And then here you have the business processes. And when you have processes here, they need to be able to map into from the profit, the value, into the processes. And here you have your resources. So for startup, you have your tech, and you have your HR people, you know, special skills, etc. A strategy map is used to show how the company vision translates from the business side all the way down to the resources it has. So I modified this a little bit and brought in a legal risk management perspective here, which showed the system requirements you develop to mitigate at risk, and you insert them here in order to have a regulatory conversation with them. So right now, if CBK comes and tells your ex company you're not compliant, there's not much you can do. But from a legal risk management perspective, if you had this kind of tools, you'd be able to tell them, well, this is our business sense, this is our customer sense, this is our value streams, this is how we manage our legal risks, and that's how they translate to our technology. So like the point you made was very important. I was dealing with a case at the Court of Justice of the European Union, a UK case, a startup that used technology to digitize analog transmissions of TV to your phone, right? In that case, one of the problems with the definition of the term cable, and it came to be that when this term was applied in law in the 60s, it just meant wire, you know, copper cable that is used in this kind of transmissions. But actually, I was able to say that there's no reason why this, even arguments in the courts, at least to up to the court of appeal, were able to say there's no reason shown why this term should not be interpreted in 2013 as fiber optic cable. So you can have risks, and you can also have opportunities in law. They lost at the EU, but they won at the UK. And when you the whole issues of interpretation and the whole hierarchies came into understanding different legal systems and how they regulate. And you have principles of interpretation that say EU law primes member state law. So for the time that UK was a member of the EU, it did that. But then you also had principles that said you cannot override a member state policy that has been legitimately chosen by the people, that this is how we want our ours to be working because of EU law. And this conflict have to be solved in Luxembourg and the Court of Justice of the European Union. So now you see interpretation is a big deal, even as you start thinking about let's get all excited about. But basically, that's what it entails. You need to be able to understand what this business does, what the legal risk arises, and how is it managed by the techie. The techie needs to understand, the investor needs to understand, the lawyer needs to understand, everybody needs to understand. And actually, that's why I got into value modeling, because value modeling helps, value modeling abstracts things to a level where everybody can understand. You understand what your value is, you understand what your value is, and all this room, we understand what our value is, that's all we do.